Hey guys, today I'm going to share with you some of the rarest skinks in America. The true Berber skink, Eumeces algeriensis. Find out more in this collection spotlight.
You are watching Reptile Mountain TV. Evidence-based, captive-bred, and animal-focused.
Welcome to Reptile Mountain TV, a channel dedicated to evidence-based reptile keeping, where opinion is not fact. I'm TC Houston, a former professional AZA zookeeper and current skink breeder, dedicated to providing quality information to the global skink community. Now, if you're new, please go ahead and hit that subscribe button and that bell so that you don't miss an upload. And if you're not new and haven't subscribed, what are you doing? Subscribe already. Today, I want to share with you true Berber skinks, also known as the giant orange skink, also known as Algerian skinks, and one of my favorite, the Boulan. Before I go, please make sure you check out Cages Custom Reptile Enclosures at reptilecages.com. Why do people keep calling them true Berber skinks? Are there false Berber skinks? Well, sort of. Let me tell you a story called The Tale of the Two Berbers. These animals were fairly common in pet shops all over the U.S. up until the 1990s. Now, I'm not certain on the exact dates. Just like most Indonesian blue-tongue skinks in today's market and many other reptiles in the pet trade, true Berbers were all wild-collected animals imported from their native countries in relatively high numbers. And the supply, it kind of seemed unending. Then, just as captive breeding in the reptile hobby was starting to gain traction, the exportation laws in their native lands, the Berbers' lands, changed, and these great animals were no longer allowed out of their countries of origin, and therefore, U.S. Fish and Wildlife wouldn't let them in either, obviously. Right about that time, a similar yet smaller species called the Schneider's skink, Eumeces schneideri, which sounds fun to say, began to be more heavily collected from nearby Egypt and imported under the same name Berber skink. And since skink keeping was still in its infancy and communication was limited, very few people were the wiser. To be fair, it's important to keep in mind that back then there was no Googling an animal to see a photo. In fact, most import lists were literally just that, lists. They were on this thing called paper, and those lists were distributed by this system, you won't believe it, called the postal system. How archaic. So, some keepers, or skink connoisseurs, if you will, chose to clarify which Berber skink species by calling the first species to be named Berber skink true Berbers, which is the larger of the two, this here, Eumeces algeriensis. So let's get into something a little bit more in depth, like their natural history and captive care. This species can be found in western Algeria, a good portion of Morocco, and a small portion of Spain. They have a decent amount of diversified habitat preferences throughout their wild range. However, they are most abundant in temperate forests, grasslands, and some arid scrub regions. They are omnivores by nature and will feed mainly on anything they can catch, which is mostly insects or carrion, as well as flowers and vegetation. Although they can also be fierce little critters and take on some formidable opponents. Now, they are diurnal, meaning that they are active during sunlight hours and can be observed hunting for their food in mid-morning hours and occasionally perched on a rock or acacia tree, soaking up the sunlight. Many portions of their range has major temperature shifts, sometimes over 30 degrees Fahrenheit from day to night time, raising up over 100 Fahrenheit ambient, surface temps of course much higher, down to 70 degrees Fahrenheit ambient after dark. Now let's talk captive maintenance. All savvy reptile keepers should familiarize themselves with wild habitat and the behaviors of whatever species it is that they keep to help better replicate, to their best of their ability, those parameters in captivity. That's often what we did at the zoo, and that's what we want to do here. Like I mentioned, these guys are diurnal, and they like to bask, so it would be wise to provide both a high heat basking area as well as UVB light to help them with both their psychological state as well as their metabolic needs. Now, according to other keepers in both the U.S. and Europe, as well as field herpers who've made some in-situ observations of this species, they can and do seek high-temp basking areas for short periods of time. So I keep my basking areas between 110 and 120 with an ambient temp of 75 to 85. I also incorporate a nighttime cool drop down into the low 70s. Now, like I mentioned a second ago, their habitat is mostly grassland, temperate forests, as well as some arid scrublands. And I should also note that it is very easy to assume that the Moroccan or Algerian temperate forest looks just like ours in the U.S. Not quite the case. Here is a photo I'm sharing under copyright fair use exemptions of a temperate forest where two Eumeces algeriensis were found in Morocco. Not quite the same as the temperate forest of the eastern USA. Also, many predatory animals, including our little omnivorous berbers, hunt on the fringes of habitats, sometimes called transitional zones. Examples of that are like the forest edge in a grassy field, or where rocky slopes turn to flat scrubland, because at these intersections there is prey from both types of environments, which doubles the bounty. So here is some video of a wild Berber in Morocco in that transitional area between scrubland and arid desert. Knowing this helped me to create a display setup for my animals. I used a clay-based soil that has some sand and rock chips, much like what you see in this in situ photo. Now, I also added some branches and rocks for hiding and basking. Some keepers, myself included, have had great success. My success is limited to the brevity of keeping time, with cypress mulch and organic topsoil mixture as a substrate. Now, I also use coca husk for the two animals that I have paired for the season. Now, some keepers have housed the species in groups, but that's been with very limited success. They're fine together as babies and young juveniles, but once they are adults and sexually mature, the animals of the same sex, they tend to fight. So, especially the females. So, a pair, one male, one female, is what has been recommended by the majority of Berber keepers. Now, they've also found that like a 40-gallon breeder size enclosure or larger works well for a single pair. I personally keep my pair in a 3-foot by 2-foot tub, which is a little bit larger, like how I keep my adult blue-tongued skinks. And I also keep single lizards in Exoterra large lows that have the same floor space as a 40-gallon breeder. Now, in captivity, they eat similar diets to blue-tongued skinks, actually. They can eat high-quality wet cat food, dog food, prepared mixes such as like Rapace's Bluey Buffet, grub pie, and veggie burger. They also eat different insects and vegetation as well. Now, this species is lean by nature, and the animal should be fed to maintain that. That means that some of the rich canned foods can cause obesity in these animals. And if that's fed in excess, a few vets have cautioned that they have a susceptibility to fatty liver disease from overly rich, high-protein concentrated canned foods. True Berbers are awesome and some of the rarest skink species in the United States and in captivity in general. When exportation regulations were implemented in their native countries, the once steady supply of wild collected animals abruptly stopped, and these animals were almost completely non-existent in captivity. Only a very few dedicated European enthusiasts maintained them and bred them in captivity. Since then, only one person in the United States has ever bred them successfully, and that was only recently within the last couple of years. Overall, there are probably about 50 Eumeces algeriensis in the U.S., with about 30 of them being recently legally imported within the past 18 months. Now, for approximately 20 years, this species has not been allowed into the U.S. by U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service due to the restrictions in their native countries. However, at least two imports were 100% legally cleared by Fish and Wildlife Service. Those imports are where my animals came from and the animals that are now in the possession of quality other quality keepers. Now, how did they get allowed in after so long, you might ask? Great question. Originally, I thought that the 2011 and 2016 updates to the Moroccan Wildlife Law, Law 2905, that allowed them to be a Category 1 in CITES, had an impact on these imports and their legality. But that was an assumption, and it was actually, I think, incorrect. I did communicate directly with the importer of these animals, who has, just to remind you, a 100% legal U.S. Fish and Wildlife cleared importation document known as a 3177. Now, that person told me that they were exported from Mali and referred to the seller as a breeder and kind of alluded to the idea that they were like captive farm bred in that country. Now, I've said in multiple other videos, typically 9.9 times out of 10, the term farm-bred, farm-ranched, farm-raised is a bogus marketing ploy to trick consumers into buying wild-collected animals. Yet, I have also said that there is bona fide reptile farms out there. I've personally seen some in Africa, specifically chameleons, and I also know of others. So it's not impossible that they were captive-bred, farm-raised, although that's not how they were being promoted. But either way, do I believe that? I certainly want to. Do I have means or power to verify it? I do not. I can't verify it. Do you? If you have verifiable evidence and fact as to how they arrived in Mali from their native countries, good, bad, or indifferent, I would love to know. But I'm going to ask you not to share your speculation. I'm also very skilled at speculation, and it does nothing to help. Comments on this video will be strictly monitored in light of that fact. Okay, here's something that's not speculation. These animals are here, alive, and in my care, and with the intention of breeding them to contribute to the captive bred population in the US. So now what? Well, that brings me to what I plan to do with them in the future. I want to prove that I'm not out to harm this hobby, that I'm not out to buy animals out of the wild, that I'm not out to make money. And so I am going to give away, F-R-E-E, free, the first six animals that I release. Not ones that I breed first, because I might keep some, but the first that I'm going to release, those first six will be free. So if I am able to breed them at that time, I will gift them to people whom I choose and feel will cherish and maybe even breed these creatures for future captive bred populations in the USA. Now, I haven't even bred them, so please don't ask to be on a list. There is no list, but stay tuned. This species is amazing, and I hope you enjoyed me sharing mine with you. So before you go, guys, check out another video right down there. And thank you for watching. Thank you, patrons. And remember, opinion is not fact.